Question also asked in prelims 2017. I am trying to give you some reference. This particular question we cannot solve fully because two other species we have not discussed right now. So, but I am trying to give you that which type of questions are asked in the examination. So if you are able to try, then you can try. We cannot fully solve this question because we have not studied about these two species, Indian wild ash and wild buffalo. But this gharial part, in the same year, the previous question also asked in prelims 2017 and this question also asked in prelims 2017. So you can see the importance of this crocodile part. This question right now we cannot solve fully because we have not studied about the Indian wild ash and wild buffalo. When this particular section we will study, then we will able to solve this question fully. But right now I am just giving you the reference that which type of question is asked in the previous year's prelims. So question is, according to the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, which of the following animals cannot be hunted by any person except under some provision provided by law? Cannot be hunted by any persons means there should be a higher degree of protection, and in the Wildlife Protection Act higher degree of protection is given under the Schedule 1. So indirectly this question is asking that which all species are under the Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act 1972. So we know that gharial is under the Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act, but these two species we have not discussed now, but I am telling you that these two species also under the Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act 1972. So the answer should be D. So when we will study this particular part also, then this particular question will again come. Then, because then we will be able to fully solve this question easily. Okay. So right now, gharial is listed under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act. Although all the three species of the crocodile, maybe it the mugger or saltwater or gharial, listed under the Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act 1972. Okay, so now I am moving to our next topic. Next topic is also was in news in June 2020. We are discussing the June current affair. So this particular topic was in news in June month. The topic is related to the aerosol optical depth. So what is the meaning of this term, aerosol optical depth? First of all, what is aerosol? Aerosol, before aerosol are some, maybe some particles that may be in the sun, available in the air or water, maybe the dust particle, maybe smoke or any other exhaust by the some type of industries. Some small particles which are available either in air or water, those are called aerosols. I will discuss it later also. But right now I am discussing aerosol optical depth. What it represents? This term is very important. Aerosol optical depth. So aerosols have some properties. So this is small particles, maybe dust particle, smoke particle, or some other particle. These particles have some tendency. This, what is a tendency? This is the sun. This incoming solar radiation. This particle have tendency to reflect the sun rays. So when this aerosol particle will reflect the sun rays, then the temperature at the land will be less. So this aerosol particle can be used to reflect the incoming solar radiation. So indirectly, it can be used to reduce the global warming. Because when this sun rays will directly come to the land, then temperature of the earth will increase, and it will lead to the global warming. But the aerosol present in the atmosphere, maybe it the dust particle, smoke particle, they reflect this sun rays. So indirectly they are helping to reduce the global warming. So these are the main use of aerosol. Another use is, these aerosols can be used as a particles on which cloud is formed. So if the cloud will be formed, then it will start raining. So it's when it will rain, then temperature also will decrease. So directly also it is contributing to reduce the temperature, and indirectly also it is contributing to reduce the temperature. So it is the use of the aerosol. So now what is the aerosol optical depth? So this particular particles in the atmosphere, these particles may be dust, smoke, or other pollution related emission. The particle can block the sunlight by absorbing or by scattering light. So this particular terms aerosol optical depth, it represent that how much direct sunlight is prevented from reaching the ground by these aerosol particles. That if aerosol particle is present, then it will block some sun rays. And if it is not present, then sun rays will directly come to the lens. So due to their presence, how much sun rays prevented for to reaching the ground, this particular term denote the aerosol optical depth. So if the aerosol optical depth is one or high, so it will indicate is haze-like condition. You can see in this particular image, there are many particles, this haze-like condition. And if the aerosol optical depth is low means it will be clear sky type condition. Here you can see in this particular image. So meaning of the term is important because nowadays many questions are asked regarding particular, they will mention some term that recently a term was new in news like the aerosol optical depth. What is the meaning of this particular term? Simple type of question is asked many times. So you should know the meaning of this term. So this term is indicating that how much sunlight is penetrated from reaching the ground by the aerosol particle that indicate the aerosol optical depth. So why it is in news? It is in news because our institute, that is ARIES is the Aryabhatta Research Institute of Observational Sciences. They have found that radiative forcing of aerosols. What does mean by radiative forcing? Radiative forcing means the effect of anthropogenic aerosols. What is the effect? The effect is that it will reflect the sun rays and it will act as a particles on which cloud can be formed. This is the anthropogenic effect of aerosols. For this particular term, the new term is mentioned, that is the radiative forcing. It is found in the studies that higher this particular radiative forcing of aerosols means the effect of anthropogenic aerosols. Anthropogenic aerosols means the aerosols emitted by the anthropogenic activities, maybe due to power plant or maybe some other activities, those aerosols are released in the atmosphere are called anthropogenic aerosols. And in the studies, it is found that this particular anthropogenic aerosols have much higher concentration over the Western Trans-Himalayas. So for this particular news, this term aerosol optical depth was in news and the aerosol is in news. This is the reference point just, and we have to inference the related news which can be asked in the prelims examination. So we are now inferring, we are interpreting the important news which can be asked in the prelims. So first of all, here can be asked, what is the aerosol? What is this radiative forcing? Radiative forcing means the effect of the anthropogenic aerosols. Those are called aerosol radiative forcing. So this aerosol radiative forcing is the effect of anthropogenic aerosols on the radiative fluxes at the top of the atmosphere, at the surface, and on the absorption of radiation within the atmosphere. Means this ARF, it is indicating that what will be the effect of anthropogenic aerosol. For this particular, the term is mentioned radiative forcing of aerosol. And aerosol optical depth, it will represent that how much sunlight is blocked by these aerosol particles from reaching the ground. Okay, so in the studies, it is found that this aerosol radiating forcing value is top at the atmosphere where mostly low over Henle and Mera. At this particular location, this particular value was low. And this Henle and Merak is situated in the Ladakh and it is a part of Indian Astronomical Observatory. So for this particular slide, only three term is important. One is what is aerosol. Second is aerosol radiative forcing, means the effect of anthropogenic aerosols. And third term is aerosol optical depth, means how much sunlight is prevented by the aerosols that was reaching to the ground. So this three term is important from this particular slide. Now I am moving to the aerosols, that what is the aerosol? you will get to know each and every important news which can be asked in the examination. Some news may be in the next slide or next to next slide, but you stay with me, you will get to know all the important news related to this, that particular topic. Okay, so what is aerosols? So aerosols are this tiny solid and liquid particles. It may be solid particle or it may be liquid particles suspended in the atmosphere are called aerosol. It may be through to the natural sources also, and it may be due to the anthropogenic activities also. Natural sources like the sea salt, mineral dust, these are the sources of natural sources, volcanic activity. In the volcanic activity also, some particle is released, those particle also act as aerosols, but the source is natural source. Other one is anthropogenic, means a human induced sources, like from the fossil fuel combustion, this is the main source of aerosol from the anthropogenic activities. Okay, so this aerosols may be natural also, but and it may be anthropogenic activities also. So this aerosol, so I have explained you the function of the aerosol. The sunlight was coming, aerosol will reflect the sunlight. One function was reflecting the sunlight, and another function was acting as a condensation nuclei on which the cloud will be formed. So these two are the main functions of the aerosols. So aerosols affect climate by scattering sunlight back into space. Okay, and another one is it seeds to help form clouds. How cloud will be formed? Formation of a cloud and all these things you will study in the geography section. Okay, and there are different type of clouds also: cumulonimbus cloud, cirrus cloud. All this geography related thing, purely geography related thing, you will study in the geography section. Okay, so this particular aerosols are mainly found in the low layers of the atmosphere. Why? Because the source is on the surface of the earth, so it is mainly near the surface of the earth, less than 1.5 kilometer. But some aerosol may be at the higher locations also, in the stratosphere also. That is mainly due to the volcanic aerosols ejected into the high altitude layers. So from this particular slide, you need to remember that aerosols are solid and liquid particle suspended in the atmosphere. They may be they may be from the natural sources, and they may be from the anthropogenic sources. And mostly the aerosols are confining to the low layer of the atmosphere, and they have mainly two functions. One function is to scattering the sunlight back into the space. Space or reflecting the sun rays, and another one is to act as a condensation nuclei for the cloud formation. Okay, here you can see in this particular image also that aerosols have mainly two functions, which is shown in the image also. Here it is sun rays is coming. This aerosol particle may be due to this anthropogenic activity, or maybe due to natural activity also. Like here it is in the volcanic activity, some aerosol may be volcanic activity, some may be from forest fire, some may be from dust particle, some may be soot particle, some may be other hydrocarbon, whatever may be, those all particles, those act as aerosols. And these aerosols will reflect this sun rays is coming in this particular direction, and it is reflected by the aerosols in this direction. So this is the direct radiative forcing. And other use was, it acts as a condensation nuclei along which cloud is formed. And when cloud will be formed, it will start raining. And when it will be rain, then temperature will decrease. So it acts to reduce as a global warming also. So it is the indirect radiative forcing. What was radiating forcing? Radiative forcing means effect of anthropogenic aerosols. So this is the direct effect, it is the indirect effect. So aerosol radiating forcing, one is direct, another is indirect. Radiative forcing means effect of the anthropogenic aerosols. So now we are moving to the effects. Effects already I have explained you, but here just written in the form of words. So it will affect the atmospheric chemical composition. It will reduce the visibility, because if there will be many aerosol particles, then it will reduce the visibility. I have seen you through that particular image also. And it impact the air quality. It will disturb the air quality and it will impact the human health also. Okay, because these aerosols are very minute particles and it can cause the damage to our heart and lungs also. And it acts as a condensation nuclei along which cloud is formed. So these all are some effects of the aerosols. Now this particular question is asked regarding the prelims 2019. So regarding the aerosols, what we have studied? Aerosol, what is the aerosol? What is the radiative forcing? Radiative forcing means effect of anthropogenic aerosols. For that term is used radiative forcing. And third one is aerosol optical depth, means how much sunlight is prevented from reaching the ground by the aerosol particle. After that, we studied the aerosols and their sources, means it may be natural and it may be anthropogenic. After that, the two effect, one was direct, another was indirect, and some more effect also, which it can affect our air quality and human health also. So now we are moving to the question which asked in prelims 2019. So we have some information on the basis of that information, you need to solve this question. Because in this question, two term is mentioned. One is cirrus cloud thinning technique. Right now we don't know what is this technique. Another one is injection of sulfate aerosol. For this particular term, we have some information. On the basis of some information, you have to solve this question. Okay, try to solve this question. What will be the correct answer? Mention in the comment section. What will be the correct answer? Please mention in the comment section. At least try everyone. Whatever information, we have information about the aerosol, some basic information. On the basis of that, we need to solve this question. So most of the students are going in right direction. Their answer is correct. Okay. So in the prelims also, this question asked in prelims 2019, one second. In the prelims also, question in the prelims examination, some question will be based on around whatever level of your study. With sure shot, you will be able to answer maybe that very thing, but approximately 40 to 45 question you will be able to answer sure shot, that you have confidence that it should be the correct answer. After that, you need your knowledge. Whatever thing you have studied, that particular knowledge and practice. This particular two things will help you to solve more questions than 40 or 45. After that, by the application of this knowledge, application and analysis of this knowledge and practice, you will be able to solve the question more than 40 to 45 questions. So for that, you need to practice the previous year's question, because previous year's question will provide you the exact way in which direction UPSC is going and how the question is framed. And accordingly, you need to tune your preparation according to the demand of the UPSC. Okay. So here, where we have some little information regarding the aerosol, but we are going to solve this question. How? Just stay tuned with me. In the context of which of the following do some scientists suggest the use of cirrus cloud thinning technique? Right now, we don't know what is this particular technique. And the injection of sulfate aerosol into the atmosphere. We have some idea regarding the aerosol. So what can be the possible effect? Okay, so what is the use of aerosol? Aerosol have two use. I have some basic use. Aerosol can be used to reflect the sun rays. One use was this. It will reflect the sun rays. And another one, it will act as a condensation nuclei and it will help in cloud formation. Okay, so now what could be the possible option? Creating the artificial rain in some region. If you are able to relate your 6, 7, 8 class, this artificial rain in that particular thing, it is used silver iodide. So it is not correct. Reducing the frequency and intensity of tropical cyclones. Cyclones and aerosols, we have not discussed something like this. Reducing the adverse effect of the solar wind on the earth. Solar wind and aerosol also we have not discussed. Reducing the global warming. Yes, it is possible. How? Through both the ways. If this particular sun rays will be reflected, then also temperature at the earth surface will be less. And when this particular aerosol will act as a condensation nuclei, then also temperature will be reduced due to rain activity. So the answer should be D. So here we are not aware about the cirrus cloud thinning technique. This technique also used to reflect the incoming solar radiation. But despite knowing this particular technique, we are able to solve this question. And this particular habit of solving the question through the right knowledge and their application, you need to develop. Because after the 40-45 question, you have to use this particular technique. Then also you will be able to solve more questions than 40-45 questions in the actual prelims examination. Okay, so you need to develop this particular technique. Any question, if you are not knowing anything also, you need to read that particular question with very patiently, because when you will read that particular question and options patiently, then also you will get some clues. The whatever knowledge you have gained and whatever thing, other thing related to that particular thing you have studied, from that you will get something, some information. On the base of that information, many times you will be able to solve the question. Okay, so right now we are moving to our next topic, that is the mass extinction. This particular topic is also news. This particular topic is related to the sixth mass extinction. Okay, sixth mass extinction. So this particular topic is in news because there was a study on their journal was released, and the study was at National Academy of Sciences of the United States of America. Where the study was, that is not important. But this term related to the sixth mass extinction, it is important, because in this particular study, it is observed that this ongoing sixth mass extinction, what is the meaning of the extinction? What is mass extinction? So there will be depletion of the species at a very mass scale, very high scale. The species will be, many species will be we will be died at a mass scale. Then we use the term mass extinction. So the, in the study, it is found that this ongoing mass extinction, it is the most serious environmental threats to the persistence of the civilization. So from our point of view, this term mass extinction is important. This institute is related to the USA. That is not important for us. This term mass extinction is important. I am trying to explain you that how you have to identify that which term is important for our examination point of view. Because if you will read everything, then you will not be able to complete the syllabus itself. And when the syllabus, you will not be able to complete the syllabus, then you don't have the confidence. And without the confidence, you will not be able to solve, clear the prelims. So for that confidence component, the related information, which is important for the prelims examination, for that information, you should have the clarity and you have to cover that part comprehensively. Okay. So for our point of view, examination point of view, in from this particular news, what is important? Sixth mass extinction. It is important for us. So what is it? So meaning of the term mass extinction is extinction of the species at the mass scale is termed as mass extinction. So what is the mass extinction of the species? When this term mass extinction is used, it is used when there is a substantial increase in the degree of extinction. When the degree of extinction is increased substantially, then we use the term mass extinction, or when the earth loses three-fourth of its species in a geologically shorter period of time, then also we use the term mass extinction. Till now, from the history of the earth, five mass extinction have already been happened, and right now its sixth mass extinction is going on. So what is this sixth mass extinction? This sixth mass extinction, it is referred as the Anthropocene extinction. Anthropocene, anthro word is mainly used for human induced. So in this particular type of extinction, the role of the human is more. Okay. So researchers has described it as the Anthropocene extinction because it is the most serious environmental problem. Because in this particular mass extinction, sixth mass extinction, the losses of the species will be permanent. Very important word. Species are disappeared, then again regenerate, again disappeared, regenerate, this cycle going on. But in the sixth mass extinction, it is said that the loss of the species will be permanent. This permanent word is important. Mean permanently we are going to lose the species. For example, this some mammal species 1-2 decades ago, like the this cheetah, lion, giraffes, were number was very more, but now they are in endangered condition. So their number are declining very rapidly. So the meaning of the term mass extinction you have understood, then when the degree of the extinction is very large, then we use the term mass extinction, or when the 3/4 of the species are reduced in a short period of time, then we use the term mass extinction. So till now, five mass extinction has happened, and right now sixth is going on. Here it is given the name of the different era, like the late Ordovician, late Devonian, Permian, Jurassic, Cretaceous. In this particular first mass extinction, 85 of species were lost. In second, 75. 85% lost and again regenerated. Then 75% lost, then 25%, then 80%, and then 76% in fifth mass extinction. And right now, sixth mass extinction is going on, okay? So what is the reason? What was the reason for this mass extinction? The reason for this mass extinction is it is caused by the catastrophic alterations of to the environment. The changes in the environment at a very fast rate. That is very catastrophic alteration. It is the reason for the this mass extinction. For example, the volcanic eruptions, depletion of the oceanic oxygen, or the collision with an asteroid with the Earth. These all are the reason for the earlier fifth mass extinction. Okay, but after all this, again, after the million of years, again species started regeneration. But what is the reason of the 6 mass extinction, or the 6 mass extinction by what happens when species go extinct? When jab species chali jayegi, tab uska effect kya hoga? Ye, it may be a possibility based question. Because I have told you in environment section, some possibility based question is also asked. Like in previously also we have discussed some question. The question was like, if all the phytoplankton of the ocean is removed, then what will be the possible effect? If all the butterfly is removed, then what will be the possible effect? If the global temperature increased by 2 degrees centigrade, then what will be the possible effect? So this type of possibility based question can be asked. So here also one possibility based can be formed. Okay, that what will be the possible effect when all the species will go extinct? So some of the possible effect is written here, and if the concept is clear, then you will be able to eliminate the option and you will be able to arrive at the right option. Okay, so basic thing you should know, and after that the analysis part will develop when you will solve more and more question. So what will be the possible effect? So when all the species will go extinct, then there will be loss in the crop pollination, because the pollination will not be happen. And when the pollination will not be happen, then this plant will not be able to produce the thing, and it will disturb the whole food chain. And there will be no water purification. It will impacting the food chain in the static part. We have discussed this particular concept, that for example in the ocean, this is the phytoplankton is the primary producer. On those is dependent of zooplankton, and on zooplankton is dependent on small fish, and on the small fish dependent big fish. So in this way it is the food chain. So for example, if this phytoplankton is removed, then zooplankton dependent on phytoplankton here for their food and nutrient requirement, their population will also disturb. And if their population will disturb, then fish population will disturb. So in this way it will impact the whole food chain. Okay, and effect of the extinction will worsen in the coming decades, as a resulting genetic and cultural variability will change entire ecosystem. Because if the many species will go extinct, then the effect will be at a more higher level, because it will disturb the entire food chain. So on the basis of the options, you can eliminate the, means that if the concept is clear, then you will be able to eliminate the option. For example, this particular question asked in prelims 2018. So what will be the correct answer? You solve and mention in the chat box. This question asked in prelims 2018. Everybody at least attempt the question. Question may be right or wrong, doesn't matter, but you at least attempt the question. After attempting, mention in the chat box. So this particular question asked in prelims 2018, question is regarding, one second. Please mention in chat box, whatever your answer. Okay, so the question is, the term sixth mass extinction or sixth extinction is often mentioned in the news in the context of the discussion of the meaning of the term mass extinction it is talking about. So if you will go by all the option, the fourth option, mankind's over exploitation, misuse of natural resources, fragmentation, loss of natural habitat, destruction of ecosystem, pollution, and global climate change. This particular term is indicating towards the mass extinction. These are the reasons which are listed that are responsible for the mass extinction. So this particular term is indicating toward the mass extinction. The question was, the term is often mentioned in the news in the context of the discussion of. Answer should be answer D. Okay, so this particular question asked in prelims 2018. So in this way, questions are coming in the prelims examination. So right now we are moving to our next topic, that is the oil spill in Russia's Arctic region. So this particular news was also in news in the June month. We are discussing the June 2020 current affairs. So news is oil spill in Russia's Arctic region. So first of all, it is oil spill. Location, Russia's Arctic region. So on the basis of this particular news, what we can infer, means which type of question can be asked. So after the oil spill, what was the reason? Before that, one thing I was explaining you. One thing is, that is the permafrost. What is a permafrost? After that, I will go to that particular news. Permafrost is like this type of image. It is the ice, but this ice is in frozen form. This water in the frozen form, it transformed into the ice. And when this ice remains frozen form for consecutively more than 2 years, then it is termed as permafrost. Okay, term is very important. So on this particular permafrost in Russia, there was one power plant was on the permafrost. Okay, so due to climate change, this is permafrost means frozen ice. Here you can see in this particular image, due to climate change this frozen ice, their balance is disturbed in the sense it starts melting. So when it will start melting, then power plant on this particular permafrost, this particular power plant have some fuel tank. This fuel tank got sink into the water because this particular balance is disturbed because ice starts melting into water. So when ice will start melting into water, then this heavy power plant balance was disturbed. So the fuel tank of this particular power plant on which it is located on the permafrost, their balance was disturbed and it got into the sink in the water. So when this particular fuel tank went into the water, then due to that leakage of the fuel tank, this particular oil spill happened. Okay, now you will be able to understand that particular news effectively. So what is permafrost? The ground that remains frozen for 2 or more consecutive years is considered as permafrost. And permafrost is composed of rock, soils, sediments, and varying amounts of ice that bind elements together. And this power plant was at Norilsk, and it is constructed on the permafrost. And due to climate change, this balance was disturbed, and the fuel tank got submerged into the water, and the oil spill happened. So now we can move to this particular news that is related to the oil spill in Russia's Arctic region. Okay, so due to this oil spill leakage of the diesel oil, around 20,000 tons of water was leaked from this particular power plant. What was the leak happen? That already I have explained you, that this thermoelectric power plant at Norilsk is the location where this particular power plant was located. It was built on permafrost, but due to the climate change, that the pillar that supported the plant's fuel tank got to sink into the water, and it led to the release of the 20,000 tons of diesel water into the Ambarnia River. This name of the river is important, because nowadays UPSC is asking question related to the location of the river, and it is integrating with some aspect of. So you should know that Ambarnia River was in the river on which this particular diesel oil was leaked, diesel oil spill happened. Okay, Ambarnia River, it is in Russia, and this particular diesel oil leakage, it is considered as the second largest known oil leak in the modern Russia's history in terms of the volume. So from our examination point of view, what is important? The important is, what is permafrost? What is the meaning of the permafrost? Where this particular oil spill happened? This is the oil spill. Here you can see this red color on this water surface. So where this oil spill happened, and if there any technique, important technique to remove the oil, if that is also important from our examination point of view. I am trying to interpret you that how you need to interpret the news, that for which particular section may be important for our examination point of view. Okay, so this location is important, because this oil spill happened at Ambarnia River. So it is the Ambarnia River. Here you can see in this particular image, this is the Norilsk, where the power plant was, and this Ambarnia River is going to the Lake Pyasino. Here it is Lake Pyasino, and from here this Pyasino River is going to the Karasi. Okay, so this is Karasi, this is the Pyasino Lake, this is Ambarnia River, and this is the Pyasino River that is going to the Karasi. And here you can see in this particular image also, it is Karasi, it is Russia, it is Russia Siberian region. Okay, and it is the Arctic Circle. Russia is a part of Arctic Council, that I will explain you in the upcoming slides. So in the geography section, question can be asked related to the important rivers of the Russia. Means, because the Ambarnia River is in news, so rather than asking the Ambarnia River, they may ask some other river also. So all the important river and lakes of Russia, that particular part you have to cover from geography section, because in geography you will study the what all important river and lakes are in the Russia. Okay, so this was the permafrost, which I already explained you, and one important and related news regarding the Arctic Sea. So I am discussing that particular news also in here itself. It was also in news in June 2020. So this particular news is related to the loss of ice cover in the Arctic Sea. So there was a study by the National Center of Polar and Ocean Research, NCPOR. उनके एक स्टडी में ये पाया गया कि जो ग्लोबल वार्मिंग के कारण जो आर्कटिक सी की जो आइस है उसका जो डिक्लाइन है 41 इयर्स में सबसे लोएस्ट, सबसे हाईएस्ट था. क्या मतलब? सो 1984 के अंदर जो आर्कटिक सी का जो कवरेज, जो आइस कवरेज है यहाँ तक है, यू कैन सी इन दिस पर्टिकुलर इमेज. बट ड्यू टू मेल्टिंग ऑफ द आइस इन सेप्टेम्बर 2019, दिस पर्टिकुलर एरिया रिड्यूस टू दिस पर्टिकुलर लोकेशन. सो इन द summer time, in the winter time condition will be like this. The term is sea ice. So sea ice is a frozen sea water. Whatever sea water is here, in the winter condition it will be frozen, then it will be called sea ice. But in the summer condition, condition will be like this. It will start melting. So if the melting process is more, if the melting is more than the formation of the ice, then what will be happen? Then the ice cover will reduce, because melting is more and the formation is less. So overall the ice cover will reduce. And if the formation is more and melting is less, then ice cover will increase. But what is the condition right now? Right now the melting part is more and formation part is less, due to which the ice cover is reducing. And if the same trend is continues, then by the 2050, there will be no ice left in the Arctic Sea. It is a projection from the National Center of Polar and Ocean Research. Okay, so this particular body, which is in news, so what is the important thing regarding this particular body? National Center for Polar and Ocean Research. Earlier, its name was different, but its name was changed to National Center for Polar and Ocean Research. This particular body was established as an autonomous research and development institution under which ministry it is important, Ministry of Earth Sciences. This is important thing, that this particular body is under which ministry? Ministry of Earth Sciences. And this particular body, National Center for Polar and Ocean Research, it is responsible for the maintenance of the Indian stations in the Antarctica. In the Antarctica, we have two research stations, that is the Maitri and Bharti, important. And in the Arctic, we have one active station, that is the Himadri. For their maintenance, also done by this particular body, National Center for Polar and Ocean Research. So you should know this particular information also. Now, this particular thing I was talking about, that there will be some information, but that particular information either will be related to other subject, or that particular thing already we have discussed, or that particular thing will be discussed in the further lectures, or that particular thing already have been discussed in the static part. That thing I will include as a connecting the dots. So if you will connect all this thing, then your comprehensive coverage will be. So important rivers and lake of Russia. This particular part you have to cover from the geography section, because where you, in that particular section, you will study that many rivers and important lakes of the Russia. After that, geographical aspect and mapping of important location of Russia. Now Russia is in news, so important location, important cities of the Russia, that particular exercise also you have to do. And one more related news is effect of sea level rise. So if this sea ice, it will start melting. When it will start melting, then water level will increase, and due to this increase in water level, what will be the possible effect? So here also one question can be framed like this. So this particular exercise also you have to do, that what will be the sea level rise effect. Okay, so now we are moving to the body, that is the Arctic Council. Because the question, the news is related to the Arctic region, Russia's Arctic region. This oil spill happened in Russia's Arctic region, and Russia is a part of Arctic Council. So it becomes important to discuss the Arctic Council also. So first of all, you should know this Arctic Council, it is an intergovernmental forum. It means it is an involvement between the government of the different countries which are member of the Arctic Sea, or these are part of the Arctic Sea. This particular intergovernmental forum, this forum was set up in 1996 by the Ottawa Declaration. On what was the primary objective? To promote cooperation, coordination, and interaction. Between whom? Between the Arctic states. What all are the Arctic states? The Arctic states are the countries which are part of the Arctic Sea. They are the Canada, Kingdom of Denmark, Finland, Iceland, Norway, Russian Federation, Sweden, and United States. UK is not part of Arctic Council. This point you need to remember, okay? So to promote the cooperation between the Arctic states, Arctic indigenous communities, in this particular council, there are some Arctic indigenous people also. They also have some permanent participants. This particular news is also important. So if the statement is like this, that only 8 countries named Canada, Denmark, Finland, Iceland, Norway, Russia, Sweden, and US are member of the Arctic Council. So it will be wrong statement, because some indigenous Arctic communities also part of this Arctic Council, and they have permanent participant. So the Arctic indigenous communities and other Arctic inhabitants on common Arctic issues, to make the cooperation, coordination, interaction between these communities आर्कटिक स्टेट्स, आर्कटिक इंडिजिनियस कम्युनिटीज एंड आर्कटिक इनहेबिटेंट्स ऑन विच इशूज ऑन द इशूज रिलेटेड टू द सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट एंड द एनवायरमेंटल प्रोटेक्शन इन द आर्कटिक रीजन. ओके एंड वन मोर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट रिगार्डिंग द आर्कटिक काउंसिल इज इट इज अ कंसेंसस बेस्ड बॉडी. वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. Decision are taken on the basis of consensus, means when all the member will agree, then that particular resolution will be passed. Okay, and its secretariat is in Norway, and its decision are non-enforceable. Very important point. And strictly the prerogative of individual state. It depends on the individual state either to follow or not to follow the that particular decision. And one more very important point that this particular Arctic Council, the purpose was for the cooperation, coordination, and interaction related to the Arctic issues. But it specifically does not cater the military security aspect. So this military security aspect is excluded from the this particular mandate of the Arctic Council. This particular point also you need to remember. Okay. And there are 8 members already. I have explained you. And what is the status of the India? India have the observer status. India is not the permanent member of the Arctic Council. India, China, South Korea, Singapore, Italy, Japan, they all have observer status. Very important point. Okay. So all this important news regarding the Arctic Council. And what all are the members of the Arctic Council? That also you can see from this particular image. This is the Arctic Circle. And what all are the member? Russia, after then Finland, Sweden, Norway, Iceland, Denmark, Canada, and Alaska region, which belong to right now belong to USA. UK is not part of Arctic Council. Okay, this particular thing is very important. So now the oil spill happened. So for the removal of the oil spill, one particular bioremediation technique is important, and that particular bioremediation technique is oil japper. Oil japper. One second. This particular bioremediation technique. What is the meaning of the bioremediation, which we will study in the static section also. But right now, just giving you passing reference. Bio means that is something related to the living things. Remediation technique means to remove the sludge formation, that is the hydrocarbon compounds available inside the oil. If we use the living component, biotic component, then we use the term bioremediation. Okay. So in this particular oil japper, we use the 5 different type of bacteria, and with the bacterial action, with the living thing, that is a bacteria, due to their action, if the hydrocarbon compound is removed, then we use the term bioremediation technique as oil japper. Okay. So in this particular technique, we use the 5 different type of bacteria, their mixture, and this particular bacteria convert the oil sludge. Oil sludge means the hydrocarbon compound available inside the oil, and it convert into carbon dioxide and water, which is the harmless component of this byproduct of this particular activity. So this particular thing you need to remember: what is oil japper, what is their end product is carbon dioxide and water, and oil japper is a bioremediation technique, and it convert the sludge of the sludge of the oil into harmless CO2 and water. So this particular thing you need to know. Oil japper and olivarus as all both are used as for this bioremediation technique. So now this particular question asked in prelims 2011, you can solve this question and mention in the comment section what should be the correct answer. Please mention in the comment section. Please mention what should be the correct answer. Sorry, yes. So this question asked in prelims 2011. The question is, recently oil japper was in the news. What is it? What is oil japper? It is an eco-friendly technology for the remediation of oil sludge and oil spill. So yes, it is the correct answer. So it option A is the correct answer. Because now you can interpret which type of question are coming. Simply a term is in news and what is this particular term is about. So in this way, we have to prepare a topic so that we can solve the maximum number of questions. So now we are moving to our next topic, that is the increase in ozone levels. This particular news was also in news in June 2020. Why it was in news? Because according to the study of the Center for Science and Environment, it is observed that in the month of June, that this harmful pollutant, that is the ground level ozone, this particular ozone level, I am talking about ground level. Because this stratospheric ozone is good for us and this ground level ozone is harmful to us. Okay, so I am talking about ground level ozone. So it is observed due to the study of the Center for Science and Environment that this in the month of June, this ozone level, ground level ozone concentration increased drastically. So this analysis was based on the Central Pollution Control Board data from the 22 cities in 15 states. So this is the news. So what is important for us from examination point of view that we have to interpret? Because if we will interpret that what is important for us, then our preparation should be according to the demand of the examination. So we have to develop that technique that we can interpret that this particular, whatever questions can be asked related to this particular news. So for this particular news, question can be asked regarding the ozone. What is the ground level ozone? How ground level ozone is formed? What is this body, Center for Science and Environment? What is this Central Pollution Control Board? In the previous years, already question has been asked regarding the CPCB. So we are discussing the ozone gas. Ozone gas, this is the O3. Chemical formula is O3. So the stratospheric ozone, which is called good ozone, that is useful for us because it protects the human from the harmful ultraviolet radiation. Whereas the ground level ozone, that is very highly reactive, and that particular ozone that is produced at the ground level that have very adverse impact on the human health. Okay, so that ground level ozone, if that is exposed for 1 hour, then also it is very dangerous. So for the calculation of the ozone concentration, ground level ozone concentration, it is taken 8 hours average, rather than for most of the other pollutants, it is taken as 24 hours average because it is more harmful to us and it is highly reactive. So one very important terms that ozone is not directly emitted. It is formed by the photochemical reactions. It is formed by the oxides of the nitrogen with the combination of volatile organic compound in the presence of sunlight. And it formed the ground level ozone. So sunlight is very important component. So in the night there will be no sunlight, so ground level ozone formation will be very less, or we can say there will be no ground level ozone formation in the night time. But in the daytime there will be sunlight. So due to this, a reaction between the oxides of nitrogen, which can be released from the vehicular pollution, from the thermal power plant or other pollutants, and we discussed in the nitrogen cycle, what is the source of nitrogen and oxides of nitrogen. That particular part we already have discussed in the nitrogen cycle of our static part. So whatever may be the source, from that particular source, when oxides of nitrogen is released, when they combine with the volatile organic compound. What is volatile organic compound? Term itself, it says volatile. Volatile means whose boiling temperature is very less. So easily it volatile means it becomes in water vapor, in vapor condition easily. Those components are called volatile organic compound. It may be from the paint that we use in the house. It may be nail polish, mostly girls which use in on their nails. Nail polish also contains volatile organic compound, and many other sources also. So whatever be the sources, when this volatile organic compound reacts with the oxides of nitrogen in the presence of sunlight, then ground level ozone is formed. This particular reaction is important. Okay, so ozone is not directly emitted. In this particular slide, I am talking about ground level ozone. Okay, so it is formed by the photochemical reaction between the oxides of nitrogen and other volatile organic compounds and gases in the air under the influence of the sunlight and heat. So sunlight and heat is important. In the presence of that, this particular photochemical reaction will be taking place. And so in the daytime, there will be more vehicle on the road, so vehicular emission will emit the more oxides of nitrogen. So on the daytime, there will be more formation of the ground level ozone. So it will act as a clear indication of vehicular pollution. That if the ground level ozone is more, means indirectly it is indicating that there will be more vehicular pollution on, or there may be more oxides of nitrogen released from other sources also. So here you can see in this particular image how ozone is formed. That thing I have explained you, but you can see in the image also. This is the sunlight, sun rays are coming. Here the oxides of nitrogen. It may be from the automobile or coal-fired power plant or any other sources. When this oxides of nitrogen is reacted with the volatile organic compound. So volatile organic compounds are the compounds which are evaporate at room temperature. So these compounds evaporate at room temperature are called volatile organic compound. And when this oxides of nitrogen react with the volatile organic compound in the presence of sunlight, then it form the ground level ozone. This particular reaction is important. So here you can see the upper layer ozone, that is the stratospheric ozone, that is good for us. This particular layer of ozone is protecting us from the harmful ultraviolet radiation. This is the good ozone. But this ground level ozone, which is formed with the sunlight, oxides of nitrogen and volatile organic compound, it is harmful to us. Okay, so here you can see this is the formation of the stratospheric ozone formation, which is useful for us. These are the sun rays. The sun rays, it disintegrate this oxygen molecules into oxygen atom, and when this oxygen atom react with the other oxygen molecule, then it forms the ozone molecule. Okay, this is the formation of stratospheric ozone. Okay, so what is the concept of summer pollution? The term is summer pollution. I have explained you that for the formation of ground level ozone, sunlight is important. Light is important or heat is important. So this ground level ozone phenomena is mainly sunny weather phenomena. Why? Because this presence of the sunlight in it will aggravate the photochemical reaction, which will lead to the formation of the ground level ozone. So concept of summer pollution means in the summer, the sunlight will be more. So there will be more ground level ozone formation if the oxides of nitrogen and volatile organic compound is present in sufficient amount. So here in the case of summer, this heat acts as a catalyst. It aggravates the reaction, that photochemical reaction that will lead to the ground level ozone formation. And this intense heat waves are one of the factors responsible for the increased ozone level in the country. So in the questions can be formed that what can be the possible reason for the ozone level increase in the country. So if the concept is clear, then you will be able to solve the question. Okay. So connecting the dots, what is the meaning? It means that this particular information may be belonging to other subject, or we already have covered in the static part, or we will cover in the we will integrate this particular news with the other news also. Okay. So in this particular connecting the dot part, you have to cover formation of stratospheric ozone, which already we have covered, role of ozone in the formation of smog. And now this concept of smog and the ozone, role of the ozone, that particular thing you have to prepare. Okay. But when we will discuss this smog in the static part, then we will discuss this part also. Montreal Protocol, that is related to the ozone depletion. And this Montreal Protocol we will discuss when we will discuss all the important protocols, national and international initiatives, and Kigali Amendment. So this all are the connecting the dot for this particular news. Now we are moving to the next topic, that is the State of the Environment 2020. This particular report, State of the Environment 2020 in figures, this is the name of the report. This report was published by CSE, Center for Science and Environment. So what is the name? Name itself suggests State of the India's Environment. So it is talking about the India's environment state, means it is talking about the sustainable development, livestock, forest, water, waste, air, land, wildlife, and other natural sources, resources, environmental crimes, and global environmental risk. This particular report is talking about all these things. On the report, every year one or two question is asked. In prelims 2020, there was no question. Prelims 2020, there was no question regarding the report. But in prelims 2019, there were two question. In the prelims 2018 also, there were one question. So every year one or two question asked. So if the question in prelims 2020, there was no question, it doesn't mean that in 2021 also there will be no question. They may increase the number of question of any section, or they may decrease the number of question from any other section. Okay. So you have to prepare your preparation comprehensively, because again, you will get chance after 1 year. So we cannot take any chance. We have to prepare our preparation should be comprehensively. It should be our static part also will be cleared, and our current part also should be cleared according to the demand of the examination. Okay. Because we cannot take any chance. So this particular report, what is indicating? What is the finding? The finding of the report is that, so I was talking about the report. So whenever you are reading a report, studying a report, first of all, you should know who have released that particular report. And if this particular report is giving some ranking, then if the India's ranking is improved or decreased. Ranking, if your number exact don't know, that is okay. But the trend you should know. Trend in the sense that last year, last to last year, the ranking was decreased or increased. That trend you should know. Number exactly the what is the ranking of the India, because there will be many index, many report. So practically it will be impossible to remember all the ranking of the India in all the reports. Okay. So this particular report is released by the CSE, Center for Science and Environment. And this particular report is name itself indicating State of India's Environment. So it is indicating regarding the performance of the India's environment. So what is the finding? The finding of the report is that around 50 lakh internal displacement caused by the disaster and extreme weather conditions in India. Extreme weather conditions like floods, cyclones, droughts, due to these two activities, disasters and extreme weather condition, it lead to the displacement of 50 lakh people in India itself, and it was the highest in the world in 2019. It is the main finding of this report. Okay, and this forced movement of the people, this forced movement of the people, maybe it may be environmental factor, maybe food factor or any other factor, that is called internal displacement. So meaning of the word internal displacement is the forced movement of the people. Okay, that may be due to conflict, due to violence, developmental project, natural disasters, climate change, or any other reason. Okay, and in this particular report, we count the number of movement, not the people. What does it mean? It does mean, for example, a particular location A and location B. The person is going from, a person X is going from A to B, and then going from again B to A, then going from A to C, then again going from A to B and A to C. So if we count the number, then the person is same, but we count the movement. So movement, one movement, second movement, third movement, fourth movement. So you have to remember that in this particular report, we count the movement of a number of the movement, not the people. This thing is also important. So in the report, what is the finding? The finding was that there were three main reasons for the internal migration in India. One is natural disasters, one was forced migration, and third was impact of COVID-19. If we talk about the natural disasters, then due to cyclone, cyclone was in news in related to cyclone. One question was also asked in prelims 2020. And in for 2021 also, cyclone is very hot topic because this year many cyclone have occurred. Maybe it Fani, it may be Vayu, it may be Bulbul, or many other cyclone in different parts of world also. Okay, so this particular report, State of India's Environment 2020. Here you can see a World Environment Day, this particular thing is released, State of India's Environment 2020 in figures by Center of Science and Environment. So connecting the dot, so what you have to cover from other section, or we will cover in future lectures, one is Center for Science and Environment. The related information about this particular body, cyclone location, and according to the location, cyclone are named differently. So the location of the cyclone and basic concept related to cyclone means how the tropical cyclone is formed, how temperate cyclone is formed, and that particular part you have to cover from the geography section. And the southwest monsoon, the what is the impact of the southwest monsoon and what is the meaning of the monsoon, different type of monsoon, that particular part also you have to cover from the geography section. Now we are moving to our next part. Next part is, that is Haldwani Biodiversity Park. Okay, am I audible, visible to everyone? Is there any problem? Please let me know. Is there an issue? Okay, no issue. Okay, so now we are moving to our next topic. Next topic is, that is related to Haldwani Park, Biodiversity Park. This particular news. So this particular news is related to the Haldwani Biodiversity Park. This particular park is open. Haldwani is located in the Uttarakhand. Okay, location you should know. And Uttarakhand is famous for glaciers, rivers, and some mountains. So this particular park is open. Haldwani, Uttarakhand has opened its biggest biodiversity park on the World Environment Day, that is the 5th of June. And what is the special thing about this particular park? In this particular park, there were some trees that are belong to our scriptures, mentioned in the scriptures, like maybe it Guru Granth Sahib, it may be Quran, Bible, and others. Okay, so the some species of the plant mentioned in those scriptures, we are focusing on that part to develop those trees in this particular biodiversity park, which is located in the Haldwani region of the Uttarakhand. Okay, so in this particular park, what we are focusing, there are thematic gardens, soil museum, species of plants, lichens. If you are able to remember lichens, we have already discussed in the static part. Mosses, mosses also we have discussed in the static part, and algae from the Jurassic era, vermicomposting unit, an interpretation center, state of the art weather station. So these are the focus area. So in this focus area, two words, lichen and mosses, are important for examination point of view. And both of these terms we already have discussed in the class itself, that's the static part. That particular slide I have mentioned in this lecture also for your reference. So in this particular plant, there are the in this particular biodiversity park, there are the many plants which have taken from the different location. For example, this Niti Mana Valley, and some from the glaciers around the Kedarnath. So from place point of view, you have to prepare this location, Niti Mana Valley, where it is located, an important city or some other important aspect related to this particular location, and important glaciers, because on the glaciers prelims 2019, one question was regarding the glacier also. So that also you need to prepare. Okay, so in this particular park, it is divided into different themes, like the spiritual, religious, scientific, human health, aesthetic value section. Different section is formed according to their uses, maybe spiritual use, religious use, scientific, human health. Okay, so in this particular type, many species will be, plant species will be grown, which is mentioned in our scriptures like the Guru Granth Sahib, Quran, Bible, and others. Okay, so Uttarakhand, there are different type of aspects, like it has alpine region, Bhabar region, submountainous, mountainous, tertiary, loamy, tarai region. All the region is available inside the Uttarakhand. It is showing the biodiversity of the Uttarakhand region. So from this particular point, what is important from examination point of view? From examination point of view, it is the importance of this particular lichens and mosses. What is lichens? What is mosses? The importance is the glaciers. Which glaciers are in the Uttarakhand? Important glaciers, valleys, important valleys in the Uttarakhand. That is the important. So what is the connecting the dot? Some locational aspect related to Niti Mana Valley and famous glaciers of Uttarakhand that you need to prepare. Different type of topographies, what is alpine, what is Bhabar region, what is submountainous, what is mountainous, tertiary, loamy, tarai, this particular section you need to prepare from geography section, and basics related to lichen and mosses. And lichen and mosses already I have explained in the static part. Okay, so that particular news related to the biodiversity park, Uttarakhand's biggest biodiversity park in Haldwani. So this particular slide, if you are able to relate, we have already discussed in the static section, lichens in the biotic interaction part, one section was mutualism. In the mutualism, both the species were getting benefit, and one of the section was symbiotic mutualism. In the symbiotic mutualism, both was benefiting. Okay, so lichen, we discussed there. Lichen is a fungal and algae symbiosis. Algae make their food with the help of photosynthesis process, and fungal need food. So that food requirement is fulfilled by the algae, and algae need nutrition and water and other mineral, that is fulfilled by the fungal. So both fulfill each other's requirement. So it is a symbiotic relationship between the fungal and algae. We already discussed this slide. This slide also we discussed, if you are able to remember. And this way question, discuss this question also, which asked in prelims 2014, the question was regarding the lichen. So lichen is a symbiotic association of bacteria and fungi. Algae and the question is lichen, which are capable of initiating ecological succession even on a bare rake, actually a symbiotic association of algae and bacteria, algae and fungi. So answer will be B, algae and fungi. After that, we discussed mosses. So there we discussed the plant categorization, In plant categorization, I told you regarding this algae mosses also. So mosses is a flowerless plant, and it act as a bioindicator. So this particular part we already have discussed from the static part. The slides I have included from the static section. Okay. So our next part is geese golden langur. So in the next part, I am discussing all that news which are in news, means those species which are in news in June 2020. So in this particular section, this geese golden langur was in news in June 2020. Okay, so this particular is the golden langur. This word golden langur came from their fur, the color of the fur. And this color of the fur of this particular species changes according to the season and according to the geography in the region they are living. So the name is coming from the color of this fur. So name is golden langur. Okay. So this langur is highly dependent on trees. This is very important thing. And it mainly live inside the upper canopy of the forest. And they are also called leaf monkeys. And they are endemic to Western Assam, India, and Southern Bhutan. It is important. And its location, geographical location is restricted to the, in the northern part, it is restricted to the foothills of Bhutan. In the east part, it is restricted to the Manas River. In the west part, it is restricted to the Sankos River. And in the southern part, it is restricted to the Brahmaputra River. So this is the geographical location where this golden langur is available. So this location aspect you should know. Okay. So what is the northern boundary, southern boundary, eastern boundary, western boundary of this golden langur? And this golden langur is one particular wildlife sanctuary, that is Chakrasila Wildlife Sanctuary. It is the India's first wildlife sanctuary where the golden langur is the primary species. So you need to remember this Chakrasila Wildlife Sanctuary. Where it is located? It is located in Assam. Earlier in prelims 2000, I think 18 or 19, a question was asked regarding the Pakhui Wildlife Sanctuary. Pakhui Wildlife Sanctuary. That what is the location of the Pakhui Wildlife Sanctuary? And the option was Arunachal Pradesh was the correct answer for that particular question. On the same line, this particular Chakrasila, it may be asked because this species golden langur is in news. So this wildlife sanctuary Chakrasila become important. So it is located in Assam. And what is the IUCN status of this particular species golden langur? It is endangered. And according to sites, it is listed in Appendix 1. And according to Wildlife Protection Act 1972, it is listed in Schedule 1. Okay. So you need to remember all this important thing related to this golden langur. Next is scarlet skimmer. What is the news? This species was also in news in June 2020. This particular name, that is biological name, this name, I have some problem to pronunciation. Crocothemiservilia, which is called scarlet skimmer. Skimmer is a dragonfly. A dragonfly means it belongs to the insect family. So this particular thing, the scarlet skimmer, whose biological name is Crocothemiservilia, it becomes very important for prelims point of view because there is some different type of news related to this species. There is one phenomena. That is the phenomena is also you need to remember. Ganandromorphism. What is this ganandromorphism? First, I am explaining this part, then I will come to this particular news. So this, from this particular image, you will be able to remember the ganandromorphism. So here it is the female butterfly species. Here you can see blue color. And it is the male butterfly species. Okay. Sorry, it is the male species and it is the female species. Top left, it is the blue morpho butterflies, a male butterfly, and top middle a female. Top middle it is female and top left it is a male. Okay, so here are some male characteristics. and here are some female characteristics. But if you see this particular butterfly, here there are some characteristic from female part and some characteristic from male part. So in this particular butterfly also, this is female part, this is male part, female part, this is male part, female, male, female, male. Means in all other species, both the characteristics of male and female is found. And this particular phenomena is called gonadromorphism, where the tissue of both the species, that is male species and female species, is found, is called gonadromorphism. Now you will be able to remember this particular point. So this particular scarlet skimmer, it is news because in this type of skimmer, this is the scarlet skimmer. It is a dragonfly species. Dragonfly species means it is a type of insect. So in this type of scarlet skimmer, this particular phenomena of gonadromorphism was observed. Means in this type of species, there was a mix of male and female external characters. This point is very important. Okay. So if we talk about this scarlet skimmer, then their male dragonfly have the red blood color, but the female have yellow color. Okay. There is some characteristic of this, because in exam you may be confused, because if they will frame the question like the option like this, that the male member of the scarlet skimmer has red body parts and the female member have yellow parts, then you may be confused that both belong to the same species, but how the color may be different. But yes, it is the case. The male have the blood red color in their body parts and the female have yellow color. That point you need to remember, because already a question has been asked regarding the Kharai camel. Kharai camel, those species which have some different type of characteristics, it is able to swim up to 3 kilometers. Able to swim up to 3 kilometers. So this was, if you will, if you think generally that it is camel, and camel is mostly found in the desert area, and it is talking about that it is able to swim up to 3 kilometers, then you will mark it wrong. But it is the characteristic of the Kharai camel. We will discuss this particular species, but I am trying to explain you that how question can be formed here also regarding this scarlet skimmer, because it is in news in June 2020. Okay. So it has both the characteristic of male and female, and it has both male and female tissues. It may be due to the genetic aberration. A genetic aberration may be due to the missing or some extra or irregular portion of the chromosomal DNA. So this term gonadomorphism, that is important. So gonadomorphism term is related that when both the type of characteristics related to the male and female are observed in the same species, then we use the term gonadomorphism. Now and possibility based importance based question can be framed here, that what will be the importance of study of this gonadomorphism. If we will study the species which have both the characteristics, then we will able to find out the genetic diversity related to that species. We will able to discover the disease, and we can take proactive actions related to that species. And on the basis of changes in that particular species, we can interpret the in human also that the different type of diseases strike on. There are some diseases which are more influential to men as compared to women. And there are some diseases which are more affecting the female as compared to male. So what may be the possible reason that we will able to integrate and interrelate if we find out this gonadomorphism, if we study this gonadomorphism in this particular species. So this may be, and many more may be the possible importance of the study of the gonadomorphism. If we talk about the dragonfly, so dragonfly belong to the insect, and it is belong to the Odonta order, and class is Insecta. That is not important, but just you need to remember dragonfly belong to the insect. Okay. And it acts as a bioindicator. Bioindicators means it if it indicate the health of the ecosystem. Okay, this particular term will again come when we will discuss the static portion in our static classes related to bioindicators. Okay, so now the next part is this particular species found at coal wetland. This particular dragonfly species which we were talking about, it found at coal wetland. So it becomes important to study the coal wetland also, because all those wetland, national park, wildlife sanctuary become very important which are in news directly or indirectly. So it is a location of the coal wetland. Here you can see this is the part of the Kerala. It is Arabian Sea. So it is spread over Thrissur and Malappuram district of the Kerala. Okay, so it is located in Kerala, and it is a Ramsar site. What is a Ramsar site and wetland? All that static portion I already have covered in the our static lecture. In the last lecture itself, I discussed related to the wetland concept and what is Ramsar site, what is Montreux record. Okay. And it is an important bird. It has been declared as important bird area by the BirdLife International. BirdLife International, I discussed in first class of our current affair discussion. Okay. So this particular wetland, it accounts for more than 40% of the rice production in the state. Important. And it is situated in the Central Asian flyway of migratory birds. Migratory birds from the colder region, they move to different location in the winter. So there are many flyways. One of the flyway is Central Asian flyway. Here you can see this particular image. There are many flyways. One of the flyways, Central Asian flyway. And on this flyway, one of the location is coal wetland. So coal wetland is part of the Central Asian flyway. You need to remember this particular part. And this particular Society for Odonate Studies, they are conducting the odonate surveys at the coal wetland since 2018. So what is important thing at coal wetland location? What is it Ramsar site or not? It is an important bird area, and it has more than 40% of rice production in the Kerala state, and it is a part of Central Asian flyway. So here you can see the location of the coal wetland and different regions of the Kerala. Here is the coal land. It is the Kuttanad, which is famous for below sea rice production. Palakkad Plains, different locations are of Kerala, you should know. So what is the connecting the dot related to this particular news? You have to prepare the related aspect of Kerala, like the important lakes, important rivers of the Kerala, that you need to cover from the geography section. Okay. Now I am moving to the next part, that is the coccolithophores. Coccolithophores, already I have explained you in the static section, but it is in news in the June current affair, so I am discussing here also. So coccolithophores, it is a single cell algae. So algae, and it acts as a phytoplankton. And phytoplankton is the species which make their food with the help of photosynthesis process. If you are able to relate our static part, if you have attended my all the static lecture, then my speed will be means there will be no problem with my speed. But you have not attended my static lecture, then there may be some problem that you may be that my speed is fast, because already those concepts I have explained in the static part. So the speed will be slightly, my speed will increase. Okay. So this particular part, coccolithophores, it is a phytoplankton, and phytoplankton is the primary species of the food chain in the aquatic ecosystem. And they make their food with the help of photosynthesis process. They take the carbon dioxide and release the oxygen. And it is the one of the source of oxygen in the oceanic ecosystem. So they absorb more carbon dioxide than they produced. So in this way, they are able to capture more CO2. So it acts as a carbon sink also. One study led by the National Center for Polar and Ocean Research, it is found that there is a decrease in the concentration of oceanic calcium carbonate. This calcium carbonate and related concept related to the coral reef. This particular concept I will explain you coral related in that our next static lecture. Okay. So here this particular topic is related to coccolithophores and diatoms. Diatoms is also single cell algae. This is the coccolithophores. Here I have integrated the static portion slides also. If we are able to relate, we have discussed the plankton is of mainly two types. There are many types, but two important types. One is phytoplankton and one is zooplankton. In the phytoplankton, they are called a primary producer in the ocean because they make their food. And phytoplankton includes diatoms, coccolithophores, cyanobacteria, and dinoflagellates. This is the diatoms, coccolithophores, cyanobacteria, and dinoflagellates. And we discussed this question also, if you are able to relate and remember the static class. So now I am moving to the next species, which was in news in prelims, June 2020. And that particular news is related to this particular fish, that is the scorpion fish. It is very important. Why? Because in one of the prelims, a question was asked regarding that recently a banana species was found. Banana species was found whose height is 11 meter. And that answer of that particular species was Andaman and Nicobar. In that particular year, I think the question was asked in prelims 2018, I think. 18 or 17, yes, 2018, this question asked regarding the special type of banana species was found at Andaman and Nicobar. So question was like this, that recently 11 meter height banana species was found in which location? And there were four options. And one of the option was Andaman and Nicobar. So in the same way, this particular question also become very important because this particular fish have some different type of characteristics. And this type of fish, this is rare scorpion fish whose scientific name is something like this, Scorpionopsis neglecta. The scientific name is not important, but you should know this rare species found from the Sethu Karai coast. And Sethu Karai coast is located at the Gulf of Mannar. Here you can see this particular location. It is the Gulf of Mannar, and it is a location where this particular species is found. It is a Palk Strait. This is the Palk Bay and Adams Bridge. So for my point of view, for environment section point of view, this Gulf of Mannar is important because here this particular special type of scorpion fish is obtained, found. Okay. So very important thing is that first time this particular species is discovered alive in the Indian water. Very important statement. In exam, you may be confused that it may be first time or many time, but first time this species in alive condition, it found in Indian waters, very important. And this particular species commonly found in the Indo-West Pacific region. Time has already become 9:30, but I am completing this particular part because it will take only 5 minutes. Okay. So I am completing this section, then we will end the class. So what is the important thing about this particular species? It is a nocturnal feeder. Nocturnal means it is active during the night time. So this is one of the very important characteristics of this particular scorpion fish named Scorpionopsis neglecta, found at Gulf of Mannar. Some other characteristics of this particular scorpion fish is that it has some sensory system, lateral sensory system. So for example, when it is acting as predator, and here it is prey, then it will sense the location of the prey, not based on eye, but on the basis of some sensory system available to this particular species. So it uses the lateral sensory system instead of eyes to hunt its prey, very important. And this particular fish has the ability to change color. It can change the color and camouflage. Camouflage means, for example, this particular background is blue. So in the blue water, it has some tendency that it will blend with the surrounding atmosphere so that their prey will not be able to identify. Okay, so they have the ability to change the color and camouflage so that they can escape from their predator, because their predator will depend on this particular species. So it will able to escape from their predator and it will be able to catch their prey due to this ability to change color and camouflage. Okay, and this particular species is called scorpion fish. Scorpion fish, because it has some spines. In spines, it contains neurotoxins. Neurotoxins means these are the substances which are poisonous to our nervous system. So that's why it is called scorpion fish. Very important. Okay, and this type of the poison which this particular species contain, it is also available in the king cobra and marine snakes. Okay, so if we will eat this particular fish, then there is chances of death. So this particular statement may confuse you, because generally fish is eaten by the people, but if this particular fish is eaten, then there may be death, because there is some neurotoxins available inside their spine. So this particular statement may confuse you in the examination. Okay, and the Central Marine Fisheries and Research Institute, which found this particular species, they have the headquarter in Kochi, Kerala. Okay, so this particular thing you should know. So now we are moving to next part, that is the Extended Producer's Responsibility, EPR. EPR was also in news in June 2020, but this particular section we will complete in the next class. So any problem or anything from this class point of view? Did you face any speed issue? Means the speed is fast or slow? Because slowly I need to increase my speed. Those who have attended my all the static class, they will be getting some clarity. And if somebody has not attended my static class or previous current class, then I will advise you first to go through those classes. But I already have attached those slides here itself. But first you will see that static class, and then you will come to current class, then it will be more beneficial to you. So you are getting clarity in this particular section, that is the environment. It is our second current affair class. So no issue. So now we will meet in our next class. There are few topics left related to the June current affair. After that, we will move to the July current affair. For environment section, whatever part I am covering, that will be more than sufficient for your current affair part for the environment section. Okay, but those thing which I have included as a connecting the dot on that part, you need to work upon, because those thing either will be related to the different subject or maybe that static related to the static part. So if you will follow my all the current classes, then for environment section it will be more than sufficient, because if other student will be able to solve the question, then you will also be able to solve the question. It is different thing that if UPSC want to play with this particular current affair part related to environment, that is different thing. Otherwise you will be able to solve the question. Okay, so we will meet in the next class. If there is any issue, you can let me know. So in the next class, our static class, we will study mangroves and coral reefs. That is very, very important for examination point of view. Okay, so that's all for today. Bye bye. Thank you.